9 o'clock, I'll call the meeting order. First, the pledge of allegiance.
Pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, first thing, we have the approval of the agenda. Do we have any additions to the agenda?
I have several potential additions for your several.
Seven.
For your consideration. First of all, under Neil Weiss, an acceptance of Eagles gambling funds for the Egg Society. Secondly, under myself, approval of a contract with Comfort Gravel for a box culvert installation. And thirdly, also under myself, and it was on your tables there, under county coordinator, information from the Boise Sioux Watershed District.
The first one, Brian, contract?
Gambling funds for the...
No, I mean the second one, contract for...
Under the county engineer box culvert installation. We've talked about it, but this is going to get formal approval.
Mr. Chairman, with those additions, I will move to approve the agenda.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carried. In your package, you've got the minutes of the May 1st regular meeting. Any additions or corrections on that?
Chairman, I move we accept that.
Okay, we have a motion.
Minutes.
I'll second.
Second by Steve. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carried. Next is the public comment. Apparently, nobody present. We'll move on to Joni, and then the dollar amount this month is.
Before we start the dollar amount, I need to amend my agenda.
Okay.
And to add financial worker resignation as another item.
Okay.
The dollar amount this month is $113,370.82. That's $113,370.82.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to accept the warrants for the amount stated.
I'll second it.
We have a motion and a second. Further discussion on the claims and warrants. Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carried.
Thank you. The next item, we have a youth activity fund, which we've actually had for quite a number of years, and it's a fund that we send letters out to the general public, some individuals, usually businesses, asking for contributions for children. We pay for things such as community education classes or maybe sports fees. These are for families that we work with, and the families don't have the means to pay for those kinds of activities for their kids. I think we pay for band, instrument rental, just those kind of things that can keep kids involved in activities, keep them connected to their peers and school activities, that kind of thing. And we've had this fund for, oh gosh, I can't even remember, many, many, many years. And the fund is actually, we don't run it through my budget, it sits in the auditor's office. And this last audit that we went through, that the county went through, the state auditor said that particular fund, actually what he first said was that every time a donation comes in, it has to come to the county board for that you're accepting this particular donation. And we usually solicit funds in the fall of every year, and so most of it comes in around the holiday time. And it seemed really cumbersome to have to bring all of those donations to the board every time, you know, 25, 30, 40, whatever the amount was. It's never a huge amount. So the auditor said that it was acceptable if the board would just pass a resolution acknowledging that this money comes into the county as donations and that you're sort of doing a blanket acceptance of those funds. And Brian, if I understand this correctly, you have to do this every year. Is that right, or is one?
That was the way I had understood it during the exit interview conversation. You know, Commissioner Sarah is there.
I think that's the way I understood it as well.
I would concur that was the way I understood it too.
Okay, so I have a resolution that just says, whereas Stevens County Human Services receives donations from the general public for its youth activity fund, and whereas state law requires that the county board acknowledge receipt of those donations, therefore, the Stevens County Board of Commissioners acknowledges and accepts the donations received for the youth activity fund. And then I will need the board chair to sign it and then I'll bring it back in another year or two. And I think this will pass muster with the state auditor.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to accept that resolution.
Okay, we have a motion. Is there a second to the motion?
I'll second.
Second, further discussion on the resolution? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried.
Okay, thank you. And then as I said, I'll bring that back every year because I expect that we'll have that fund ongoing. Okay, the next item, the maintenance supervisor. I had offered the position to our two top candidates, both of them declined. So what I would recommend to you at this point is that we obviously table that issue, and I'd kind of like to go back to the drawing board and come up with a different plan. Maybe have a conversation with some other counties and see if there's any way that we could contract for some supervision time. But I'd like a little time to explore some other options at this point, if that's okay with all of you. And then right on the heels of that, I have a financial worker resignation, and so I am requesting permission to fill that position. If we don't fill that position, then that means we have 1.2 financial workers, and that's not nearly enough to get them up there. So we will need to fill that, and Debbie's last day is May 25th. So there's not a lot of time. I'll never get the position filled in 2 weeks, but at least I can, you know, get the people going to start the process.
You already have a job description and stuff like that, so that work is done.
Yeah, and it's graded and all that. Yeah. That won't be a problem. It's just merely going through the new system process. So, any questions?
Well, certainly it would be nice if you had like a 2 month notice, you know, on a position like that.
You know, it's
give you more time.
Yeah, and I don't know if that's something that could be put into the labor agreement at some point. This is just impossible because the process to fill these positions in 2 weeks, it's not doable. And it does put us in kind of a bind when someone leaves. But yeah, it's certainly something that I've thought about.
Well, I assume the consensus of the board is you have to do what you have to do to get by or proceed or go back to the drawing board or whatever.
And as you recall, we do have Kim Gullickson, who works in Grant County, coming in after hours when we need her. And so I may need to use that up a little bit just so we keep the cases current and reviews timely and process applications timely as well.
Well, what I was going to suggest is you might want action as you have in the past practice here to accept the resignation. And then I think it would be appropriate to authorize the hiring as well. You could do it in one motion.
I would make that motion, Mr. Chairman.
A second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any more discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carry.
Okay, I'll keep you posted.
Thanks, Ted.
Have a good day. Hope you have a better day.
Well, yeah, but the childcare is the thing, we're not gonna have that meeting?
Well, I think we might on the 4th. The 30th doesn't work for me, but I'll see if I can schedule a place for the 4th. I'm thinking that.
Okay.
Yeah, and I'll let you know.
June?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. The 30th doesn't work for me, but I'll see if I can. I'll be in touch.
Thank you.
Joan, you should work with Sue to get an acceptance letter put together for accepting the resignation.
Yeah, I did put one together yesterday.
Okay, great.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, next on the agenda, we have West Central Initiative, Rick and Tom. We're a little bit ahead of schedule, but welcome.
We'll hopefully keep you ahead of schedule.
Morning, Rick.
Thank you.
Morning. Mr. Chair and Commission, I want to thank you again for the opportunity to come before you this year again. Once again, my name is Greg Wagner. I'm the Economic Development Planner with West Central Initiative. And I am here to give you both an update on the regional plan that we put together and seek a resolution of your support for this 2012 update. I did include with your board packet a 3-page summary of similar to what you got last year, and also a copy of the resolution that we're seeking your approval of. I'll go over a little bit of the highlights of what the plan is as a review, and then just some county-specific information that we've found through the course of this last year, since the last time I was here. Just as a review for what the SEDS is, it's known as the SEDS, but it's officially the Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy. That's developed as both a tool for the region and a compliance document for the Federal Economic Development Administration. It's a 5-year plan. We update it every year. It gives a big picture of the regional economic situation, and then it contains and analyzes data at both the regional and county level, both with demographic and economic related data. It identifies goals and objectives and key issues of focus. And the key issues of focus continue to be business development, workforce development, infrastructure, and planning, both economic, transportation, and community planning. It also covers county and community projects, and with the intent that those projects will benefit not just the immediate area that they're taking place in, but also the overall region. Similar to last year, or it's maintained from last year, is that the plan contains analysis of population demographics, housing, agricultural impact on the region's economy, and labor force analysis, which includes workforce numbers, unemployment, wages, and key industry sectors for both, again, the county and at the regional level. I did mention the projects. We work with local economic development staff, city staff, and stakeholders in each county and community, and identify projects that will play a role in the overall economic improvement for the region. And those projects may or may not consider applying for federal funding, but the ones that do are ranked and prioritized in the document. Last year, I did share specific project numbers with this board. This year, I extended the deadline for project submittal, and I'm still working out those specific project numbers, an inventory of what projects have been completed and status of ongoing projects. I'll move now to the more specific county level data. One thing that is usually a big highlight that we don't have new numbers on for this year is the population. We're still sticking with the 2010 census data for population. The state is required to provide population estimates every year outside of the census, but they have until July. Those usually come out in July, and we haven't seen the draft estimates yet. So the plan does just maintain what the census data had for both population and the components or the makeup of that population, both being over 65, the minority population and whatnot. There's the four industries that make up 75% or 74% of the workforce are still education, health services, trade, transportation, utilities, manufacturing, and leisure and hospitality. The top three industries in Stevens County are education, health services, trade, transportation, utilities, and manufacturing. That's 59% of the Stevens County workforce. For all jobs, the average weekly wage for the region increased by a few dollars. It's $610 per week. That's an increase from $598 last year. Regionally, the top three paying industries are manufacturing at $794 a week, information, which is $837 a week, and public administration, which is $778 per week. Manufacturing and information saw increases in wages from last year. Specific for Stevens County, the average weekly wage for all industry sectors, that's all jobs in this county, is $673 per week. The top three paying industries are the construction at $838, manufacturing at $854, and public administration at $853. All three saw actual slight decreases in wages from last year. One of the thoughts for that is that there is such a demand for jobs in Stevens County that the pay doesn't have to be quite as competitive. It's the balance of trying to compete for jobs, but you know, keep the pay at a level where they can still manage without increasing too much on salary. The unemployment rate for Stevens County in 2011 was 4.8%. That's compared to 2010, which was 5.4%. And then in 2009, it was 5.6%. So we're seeing extreme decreases in unemployment for the county. Unemployment for March of 2012 is 4.9%. Stevens County is a standout in that respect. Unemployment, especially in March of 2012 for the other eight counties in the region, is higher than it has been historically. And we've seen a bump up, and it's maintained very low in Stevens County. Per capita income did increase from the 2009 drop. For Stevens County, it's $41,148. Per capita income is the total income at the county level divided by the total population. And so it's 96% of the state level, which is $42,798. That is a jump from last year. And then 103% of the nation. So very competitive in overall for the county. Poverty rate did increase. It's higher than the state level at 12.0%. But the national poverty rate is 14%. So we're overall doing better than the nation, but most of the counties in the region are at above the state level. We are continuing to see recovery happening. Manufacturing production has increased, and this year we have now seen an increase in hiring. Manufacturing is an industry that has the ability to do more with less employees, and when hiring is happening, that is a strong sign that the economy is strengthening. Over the next 8 years, we're anticipating the following industries will add the most employees: trade, transportation, utilities, professional and business services, education and health services, and leisure and hospitality. At the state level, manufacturing is anticipated to see a decline. I don't see that decline in Stevens County at all. There's a high demand for manufacturing jobs, and there's very strong manufacturing component in the county. So I don't see there being a decrease in jobs in the next, at least what they're predicting here in 8 years. So, and as I had mentioned last year, we incorporated ag data into the document. The 2012 Census of Agriculture is not going to release data until 2014. So I'm still looking for new data sources on ag. We don't have a lot new stuff from last year, but what we do have is that corn was the top grown crop with 129,000 acres harvested. Counties ranked seventh in the state for dairy herd numbers. And in 2009, which is the most current data, Stevens County had a combined cash receipts for crop and livestock totaling $232,960 million. That is a slight drop, or a drop from 2008, where it was $314 million. 2008 was an extremely successful year in farming. So some of that drop is attributed to the weather, I would imagine. And then Stevens County does currently have two active projects listed in the SEDS. One of them has identified the potential to pursue federal EDA funding. But depending on any questions, that's all I have for you.
Could anybody have questions?
Can I do a copy of this?
Sure.
Greg, this on the ag stuff,
yes.
Is that crops and livestock that are sold?
Cash receipts, so I'm guessing that's gross. So it doesn't include the costs of input, but and then that excludes government payments as well. So that's just cash receipts for crops and livestock, so gross sales.
But that doesn't include, like, if someone increases their herd size.
Right.
Okay, so it doesn't include inventory.
Right.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions for Greg or Tom? Apparently not. Thank you. Very interesting. And
we have a resolution of support, though.
Yeah, we should forget that, I guess. Great.
They'll go away unhappy.
I don't think they'd leave without. Okay, in your package, you do have a resolution in support of 2012 update, the 2011 to 2016 Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy for West Central Minnesota. Any questions on that?
Mr. Chairman, I'd make a motion to accept the resolution as it's presented.
Okay, we have a motion. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Second. Further discussion? None in favor? Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you.
And at this time, Mr. Chair, I'd like to take just a couple minutes and give you an update on our activities. I appreciate the chance to do this, come out, and as I said, just kind of give you a brief update as to what we've done. Our 25th anniversary year has been pretty exciting. We've hosted 48 events with an estimated 2,000 people attending, including ice cream giveaways and sharing anniversary cake. We awarded $10,000 surprise grants to one nonprofit in each county in our region. And we launched an endowment fund challenge for our component funds, and 15 of those funds achieved the goal that was set and shared in an additional $75,000, which was added to those funds. And in the midst of all those celebrations, WCI made nearly $3.4 million in grants and loans last year. Our component funds were able to award over $1.5 million in grants, which impacted nonprofits in every county and nearly every city in our region. Financial impact that WCI has had in Stevens County over the past 25 years is in the sheet on the right-hand pocket of the folder that I gave you. Well, we're always proud of the grant and loan dollars that we can talk about. The real impact of, is how those dollars affect the communities and people in our region. Those effects are felt through a variety of ways, including we help establish early childhood coalitions, excuse me, in order to create safe, nurturing places for our youngest citizens to thrive and succeed in school and in life. We support organizations, projects, and individual donors by helping them build permanent funds to facilitate community growth, healthy lakes, quality schools, and a wide range of other priorities. We help with financing when businesses start or expand so there are more jobs in the region. We help bring cutting-edge manufacturing training into the area to increase workers' skills and strengthen a company's competitive edge. We help connect local leaders with people at the regional, state, and national levels on the topics of economic development, workforce development, family economic success, and philanthropy. And we work with nonprofits and units of government in the region to leverage as many resources as we can for the communities, businesses, and families in West Central Minnesota. While we're very proud of our history and will continue to promote those core programs, WC also looks for new and innovative ways to meet the ever-changing needs of the people in our region. Two new programs begun this year are evidence of that. The new Competitive Workforce Grant Program will improve the economy of the region by encouraging groups to try out new strategies to better meet the needs of both employers and workers. The Access to Capital for Small Business Financing Program will make it easier for local banks to work with WCI for certain small business financing. We know that our past successes, our new programs, and the impact we continue to have on our region would not be possible without the support we receive from the counties, cities, corporations, and individuals who share in our vision and our mission. That support allows us to continue to address the critical needs in economic and community development, youth and family services, and child care. And as you begin the budgeting process for fiscal 2013, we ask that you consider continuing that support with the request that is also included in your package. And I would also remind you that the gifts to the Unrestricted Endowment Fund of WCI are matched dollar for dollar by the McKnight Foundation, essentially doubling your gifts. We thank you for the confidence that you've shown through your support, and we are proud to call you a partner in each of these efforts. As always, our pledge to you is to continue the careful stewardship of each gift and every dollar. And with that, I will thank you again for your time and be glad to answer any questions that you might have.
It's going to be a tough crowd, huh?
Apparently not, so we appreciate your time. And
yeah, thank you for all you do.
Thanks. Thanks.
Have a good day, you guys.
Great.
This isn't my fifth one. I can be on the
left. Yeah, this will be fine. Yes.
Thanks. Thank Mr. Willis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Regarding the part-time deputy position, we had two applicants. One didn't meet the criteria. The other one was currently looking at the university now. His name is Ron Hensinger. He's worked with the sheriff's office. He's on the tactical team and is a good kid. I would ask that the board approve to hire him as a part-time deputy to take over most of what Matt Flogston has been doing, who's recently met at the full-time position at the with the city of Hancock.
So, Mr. Sheriff Willis, do you anticipate Flogston is still going to do some part-time there?
He possibly could. You know, he will be, this bad weekend coming up, he'll be working this weekend, but he, you know, depending upon, with the transports, Dave Stevenson is getting a little older and spending more time, he spends more time in the summer up in the Park Rapids area, and like Steve, the court security person, is spending a little more time gone, so when I leave here, I'll be sitting in court for the morning until that trial is over there. So it's, you know, it's possible he will be used, but not nearly to the extent he is now.
Basically, he'll still stay on the payroll as such, so.
Yeah.
And what was this youngster's name again?
Brian Hansinger. He's been employed out at the university for, I think, 3 years now. He's a member of the tactical team. He's,
Is he security or?
No, he's a police officer at the university. And he's been there since 2008. So it was when he started there. He's a veteran. He was in the Marine Corps for 4 years. And likes to do a horseshoeing in his off hours. He's a farrier too, so.
Sure, Willis, can you spell last name for me?
H-E-N-S-I-N-G-E-R. Ronald Arthur Jr.
Hansinger?
Yes. H-E-N-S-I-N-G-E-R. Currently living in Hanford.
Any other questions? He's a kid in comparison to you, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, everybody that's younger than me is a kid.
That makes the whole county board of kids too. Okay, you heard the request of the approval to hire this part-time deputy as such. Is there a motion to that effect? I'll make that motion.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I'll second it.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you very much.
You still have to file a form with the recorder's office when you hire deputies as such?
You know how what that form says.
Yes.
Serve at your pleasure. Greatest form in the world.
Just like the sheriff.
Yeah.
All right. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Well, I haven't said that.
Okay. Sue's not here yet. I suppose we could take on yours.
There's yours.
Impeccable timing. Chair's still warm.
Auditor, treasurer, payroll clerk job description. And you probably got those in your packets. If not, I just made some copies I can grab too.
Yes, they have it.
Yeah, you have it.
So that was regraded, came in at a grade 10. And so need approval to make that effective basically today with the approval of this new job description, then we'll discuss the retro pay.
Okay, any questions on the job description?
This is Lori.
Right, and the changes that were made were in the payroll section on here, which is instead of performing biweekly payroll, it was changed to manage, which means troubleshooting, talking with vendors, doing more of the entire function of it. And then also some of the, being more specific about the information created for labor negotiation. Sentences were changed.
Mr. Chairman, I will make a motion to approve this new job description for Deputy Auditor Treasurer Bill Clark.
effective today, correct?
Aye. Okay, we have a, excuse me, got a motion and a second on the job title as described. Is there any further questions? With that, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carried.
And then the question, we did get approval from the union to also move it, it'll be a non-union position, so they signed that petition, and that was sent out to the BMS. So now the question becomes, putting her onto the non-union pay scale, when we look at the 2012 scale, she's, in order to give her, you know, somewhat of an increase for this, for the new duties and everything, Neil's recommending going to a grade 10, step 6. And that would be $20.2106 per, oh eight per hour. And right now she's at, with her monthly, she's at 18.8558 currently, which would be a 1.255 increase per hour. So that's 6.6%. So that's, the first question is what step to put her on. And that's the one that Neil recommends. And she, he wants this to go retro back to July 1st of last year. She started doing this in June of last year with the retirement. So I guess we first need to decide if that's what we're gonna place her, and then decide how we're gonna figure the retro. We're just gonna ask for a stipend for the retro pay, because it would be, she was on the, she was still a union member, we can't change that, but the scales are so different, so so we're just gonna ask for a stipend for that.
Well, I guess discussion on the first step, on the classification and grade and step, any thoughts on that part?
I have these in the copier, I can grab these if you all want to see them. I have to grab one I want.
In your estimation, does that sound reasonable?
Yeah, the union contract requires at least a 4%, and so it, I think it's very reasonable.
I guess I'm okay with that part, the stipend. I think maybe we want to talk about that a little bit, what your thoughts are. And the request there would be to go back to July of 2011.
Yeah, and what I did there is I took the union grade 7, step 10, where she would have been, added the longevity, and then I went to the non-union scale, which would be grade 10, step 6, and the difference there is 1.2411 or 0.11, and so the difference, if you take half the year, would be about 1,129 or 1,129 for the whole half a year of 2011, and then I did the same for this year, kind of just figuring half a year, you know, because we're just close, and you get 1,142, so you're looking at 2,271 for the year if you figure it, you know, just based upon this, and then. Her question was, well, what about the union dues I paid that I wouldn't have had to pay if we had made this change? The argument there is she had representation during that time, regardless of the fact, so I don't know what you want to do about that, but that was the question. So if you just looked at wages alone, you're looking at roughly $2,300. If you're looking at adding in union dues that she wouldn't have had to pay, you're looking at about $2,800.
Thoughts or comments on that part of the request?
She was doing this work from July 1st.
Absolutely. Because the retirement happened June
30. How come we're just grading it now?
Because there was a lot of talk about how we were going to structure everything. We went through a lot of different things, so we didn't really start doing it, looking at it until January of this year. She was a union member, and that will not,
yeah.
Didn't change until now, because we didn't petition until now.
So she's out of the union as of what date?
We're going to go with today, because they emailed me the signed petition back, so we're just gonna collect today. Which means she's been.
I guess I would suggest that we do it retroactive without the union reimbursement myself.
And I think that's kind of where I'm going as well, I don't know what the union does, if that's.
I mean, it's a consideration for you to think about, make a decision.
I'm okay with the retroactive, I think, as well, so skip the union dues.
Yeah.
Do you wanna make it a year, 2,300? Or do you want that to be that number there, or?
2,271.
Yeah, I mean, I still, there's a little extra built in there with the, I figured mine half a year, and we're not quite at half a year, so whatever you wanna do, if you wanna do the even number, or it's 2,271.
Well, she should make it to whatever it is to today, because she's gonna get an increase from today.
Right, I can go back and figure out specifically through today, so make it the retro, figure that way, but through May.
Correct. Whatever that amount is. Stipend would be.
Okay, any other comments on that?
Take action?
Yep. I'm sure you want to take action on that.
I will make that motion to, I guess, retroactive from July 1 to May 15.
So.
I'll second that.
Let's see.
With no union reimbursement, union due reimbursement.
Okay with that?
Is that okay?
Yep.
I wasn't done yet.
Did you second that?
Yes, I did.
Okay, we got a motion and a second, further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you. And then the last item I have is.
Wait, did we do a motion for the grade and the staff?
I took the liberty of including it in the motion, however.
I forget.
Yeah, I guess so.
I worded it to approve the pay grade and step as suggested, and provide a stipend equivalent to the difference in pay from July 1, 2011 to May 15, 2012.
And then we have the question about advertising for your human resources director full-time position. I think basically just approval to advertise at the grade that GMG has come up with, and then determining how far you wanna advertise, how far you wanna reach. You know, I think I've suggested, which Brian probably passed on, you know, we can, AMC is free, so we can do that, we'll obviously do the local papers, and then we've got, we could do Alexander, we could do Wilmer, we could do Johns Headquarters, we've got HR networks and administrator networks, we can send for free, you can listserv, but just wanted to find out how far you wanna go.
I'd suggest Fergus area as well.
Reaching most directions that way.
And like you said, AMC, that'd be good as well.
And if it's on, if we put it on Jobs Headquarters, you know, that's where a lot of people are looking to, so we'll get that on with one of the papers, and then usually I just try to figure out what is their most important day, and do with those papers, you know, some aren't actively, so just try to figure out which one they think is, they get more people looking at jobs on those days and make that day, so get the most front money.
Okay, with that, you need some action on that as well, as far as advertising.
I would move that we approve advertising for human resources director.
I'll second it.
We have a motion and a second, further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carried.
Thank you.
Sue, just a second.
Sure.
Board, quickly, as we move forward and we do the advertisements, there's going to be various processes we have to go through between board meetings. For instance, outside of the typical job application, is this a position you'd like to see resumes or other supplemental questions or that type of thing prepared? Would you like Sue or myself or someone else to try and make executive decisions moving forward with that process? Or how would you like the involvement of the board and or committee thereof to help bring this in the necessary stages between board meetings? Because I anticipate there's going to have to be decisions made, not necessarily requiring board approval, but the process is going to take some time and it's going to take some decisions. And I'm not sure if you've adequately identified how exactly you'd want those to be made.
Typically, it's a personnel committee, but it can be changed. It can be anything you want it to be. So.
You expect a fair number of applications?
Mm-hmm.
And we recommend that we bring it down to 3-5 to interview.
I think you would probably want to do 5, because if you're looking for that right fit and that right person, you know, it's more about seeing them in person. It gives you a little more to.
I think we need to have all 5 commissioners involved in that interview process.
Well, I don't think you're really referring to the interview process, are you, Brian? You're referring to anything that comes up prior to that?
Right. First of all, we have the process of determining how we're going to accept applications. We have to decide whether we want supplemental questions included, or if we're just doing the, if we want to accept resumes, which for surely I would suggest we want to do that.
Supplemental questions are a little hard to score, so if we're just scoring based upon things, that could be something we even do at a second round. It's just kind of up to you.
Then you need someone or a group to filter through the applications you get to identify and score the applicants. I suppose you could do it independently as board members if that's what you choose to do. And then you need to determine whether you're moving straight to finalists or whether you're going to have preliminary interviews, which I would suggest, and then final interviews. And so all these steps take process, and you might even want them to bring examples at this level of position. Maybe there's work examples that you would like provided during the interview process. So, it's not going to be so simple as to send out an advertisement for applications, get our applications, which are extremely generic, and then try and pull out of that limited information who you're going to actually interview will be very, very difficult. I believe some type of supplement information, at least a resume and cover letter, detailing their work history. So. And then we have the process of background checks and such, which we'll do standard. But, I'm not sure if Sue will be an applicant, but that having her as a resource, if she was an applicant, would go away. And so background checks and all that stuff get a little bit more tricky. So there's where I'm going with that.
Which I can tell you, I'm just going to, you know, since I have 6 years plus at Big Stone County, I'm going to stay at Big Stone County, so that takes that out of the mix.
So you certainly use Sue more strongly.
I would be, I guess, to get through this preliminary stuff, I'd be comfortable with Sue and yourself and the personnel committee, and if we get to the point where we need to involve the board, we could make that determination.
I would suggest the same thing, and then when we get down to the finalists, I mean, then we all should be in the interview process, I would think.
Yeah, I would strongly
whether it's whether we decide it's 3 or 5, I think we can leave that up to that committee.
And if you're really looking at, we, you know, Brian kind of had a plan, kind of laid out the timeline. If you're looking at June 18th, it would be nice to kind of pencil in a couple days or days. That's even something we can tell people as they apply, that if you get an interview, this is when they will be. And people can kind of, it just helps make sure that people are available and things like that. So I don't know if you want to have some tentative days on the calendar. For here. Already only locally.
That's true.
June 18th being the interviews?
Well, he just said that week of first round interviews could be done.
Oh.
So.
I looked at, most importantly, you approved the advertisement to say that the closing date is June 8th.
I see that.
So you're gonna, it's gonna take a lot, depending, say you got 20 applications and you're gonna have 4 or 5 people score them. And they're gonna meet and concur with
each other. We can score them as they come in, but still try to have a meeting.
You know, that's gonna take the better part of at least a half day getting together. And it's gonna take another half day just for each person to walk through them. So, you know, that would probably be the week right after that. And then you have to make some decisions as far as interviewing and make arrangements. So, you lose 7 days quickly, let's put it that way.
So if you're looking at the 18th for the initial interviews and then the 28th and the 25th and finalist interviews, it would be nice to get the dates on.
The 18th, I'm busy in the afternoon.
What's the 18th?
Monday.
Monday.
It can be Wednesday the 20th, it could be Tuesday the 19th.
I won't be here either.
Okay, so the 18th we can take off the table and look at the other days that week. Are there any other days that week that are off the table or anything?
Not that I'm aware of.
What did I send on there?
You said the week of June 18th. And then finalists.
So it's just the committee that needs to be available on the week of the 18th?
No, because you wanted the whole board to do the interviews.
No, we haven't narrowed down the meeting before.
The committee's going to do all the preliminary work, but the full board's going to do the interviews. So.
Wednesday the
20th. Wednesday the 20th. I would assume you may want Aaron involved if he's available.
If you want me there, I'll do it.
Yeah. So the 20th kind of...
We'll take a shoot for the first round of interviews and then we decide if we need to do another round after that.
Okay.
That sounds fine. Mm-hmm. 20th?
20th.
8 o'clock.
Well, we'll have to set up a schedule. And
yeah.
It will likely be, you know, an hour to an hour and a half between them.
And we probably want to have a little mini meeting before we start, so it might be like 8:30 or something.
8:30 or 9 for the first one. But I would plan on all day, probably.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, sounds
today.
Good.
Thanks,
Sue.
So, we're going to have a 9-1-9-3-1 contract issues again.
Yeah,
I'm sorry. Over 40 hours. I'll work a lot. So that's
right.
Right.
Total
tackles
is short stuff before 10 o'clock?
Yeah, if you want to do that, Brian, I think it might be good. Yeah, I've got 1 or 2 things.
I would jump all the way to the bottom of the agenda, Mr. Chair, and starting with B and the additional C for county coordinator. First of all, B, you should have gotten an email from AMC. This is just a note for individuals that as a whole, you'll be potentially going to AMC at Moorhead on June 8th. Meeting begins at 8:30, I believe. Goes until noon. So that's just a note.
And the second piece, Poitou Watershed Advisory Committee, I put a packet of information on your desktops this morning. This email went to Neil and forwarded it to me. And they are setting up an advisory committee that will meet annually at this point, additionally if needed. And they're requesting the name of somebody from your organization to recommend to sit on the advisory committee, and they may or may not be chosen.
We already have that person.
Okay. So submit the names from here.
Myself and your alternate.
We have to go back to our committee appointments, but that's what it,
that's
what our committee appointment is. It's for the Poitou Advisory Committee that.
Apparently it's been enacted.
It's been, it's a committee appointment that we've had, but they've.
Not met.
Not met.
Okay. So what we'll do is I'll submit your name and you as an alternate.
I believe that's the way our committee is set up. We'd have to look, but.
Okay, I'll look at the committee list.
I think it's on the committee list.
And then submit that to John. And then it sounds like you'll hear back following their next meeting in June. That's it. Couple of quick items there. If you would like, I guess the artwork in the courthouse was suggested to be on the agenda by Commissioner Ennin, so.
Yep. You wanna do that now or?
All depends upon how long you're gonna talk.
Yeah.
You're on a timeline, so let's get it over with.
We discussed artwork in the courthouse and one suggestion that came up was from Tom Lowell soliciting pictures from different area events of Stevens County and hang them in the courthouse. And two problems that we found with that idea were if we got in several pieces, who was going to judge them? And I talked to Randy Hokinson because we do the horizontal grandeur at the museum, and I asked her who judged that. And she said they did, so I asked her if we did this for the courthouse, if she would be willing to help judge it here, and she said she would. And another problem that came up was how would we keep track of whose artwork is whose and where it's hanging? And I asked Tom if he would be willing to do that, to just keep track of whose is whose, and he said he would be willing to do that. And if we, the horizontal grandeur, when they have their contest, the people bring it framed or ready to hang, and so then there would be no cost to the county. And we could say that we want it between certain sizes so that we're not getting very small pieces and and not too big.
What's a normal size?
Well, like 18 by 20 or 11 by 14. Because you want to talk about the PRCA.
Well, I personally think I'm not that thrilled with the way that they're handling things. Plus, it's an ongoing expense every year, it will be.
And the
artists aren't making any money off of it. The money goes to them and not to the artists. So I'm leaning toward giving this a whirl.
And we talked about having a contest that in the contest we would say that the artwork would hang for a year or 2 years or whatever length we decided, and we're not dealing with the artist every year.
Right. It's something that we need to get done and not have it every year it hangs over our head.
Yep.
Have to go through this process and think to have something. And if we have volunteers to take this on, I'd say go for it. Works for me.
Sounds good to me. Just the consensus of the board is good enough on this, I would think.
I would think so.
The only expense that I could see would be advertising the contest.
Okay, with that, you make contact and get things rolling, I guess. Okay.
Well, I've got 10 o'clock on my phone. Perhaps maybe somebody should advise those who want to enter that they may do so. Yes, but
I can do that, Mr. Chairman. Anybody that's here for the 10 o'clock, they're going to start that now.
Agenda, Planning and Zoning Director Bill Kleindl, and once again, this is the second reading on proposed zoning amendments as such. And, with that, I think it's our intent too. I mean, if there is any more public comment like we did at our last meeting, I would open that up right now for public comment. Just to point out a couple things, if you do have a comment, please raise your hand and state your name, address, and 3 minutes. Try and keep it, you know, to the point. I would ask that. Second point I want to make as well, you know, if it's something that you've already said at the last meeting, I would try to refrain from repetition and repeating, I guess. I would appreciate that as well. So, with that, I'll open up the public comment, and if you have...
Mr. Chair, I have a question for you first. Are both these resolutions before us today?
Yes. Okay. For the zoning amendment as well as rezoning the property.
Okay, with that, is there any comment from anybody in attendance?
Could you have an introduction by the zoning administrator as to about the project? An update since the last meeting?
I guess as far as the last meeting, nothing has changed with the permit application. It's still the same as what it was at the last hearing that we had. I believe the county coordinator did forward to you a letter from Stevens Forward. And I don't know if the board wishes me to read that or summarize it.
Yeah.
You've got copy of it. So it's basically a letter of support for rezoning the property located under Perkins Lake for commercial use. They recognize the positive economic impact this would have for Stevens County and the connection of the current efforts of Stevens Forward, specifically the driver, which states we will integrate our parks, lakes, and trails to be the finest in western Minnesota. This project represents an effort to share our public resources, the lake, with the entire county population. And it's finished up at the same time we would hope that the commissioners would be sensitive to concerns of the adjoining lake owners as well. There was also a letter from Todd and Jeannie Travis that basically oppose the rezoning of the property to current S2 residential designation to an S3 designation. They do not oppose the use of the current structures under the current S2 designation. So, and then they also indicated that they had visited with each of the commissioners in regards to that. So. Mr. O'Reilly was into my office yesterday and had talked to me in regard to an EAW, an environmental assessment worksheet that should be done prior to any permitting out there in that property. And he also sent me an email in regard to that and asked me to direct that to our county attorney and talk about that with the board this morning. I guess in my opinion, this is an application for zoning amendment and rezoning to allow a permitted type of use to be available to them out there upon permit through a conditional use permit. And I guess it's my opinion that if for some reason in the future, I guess his point was anytime the EAW rules say that anytime you propose 25 more RV campsites in or more in a shoreline sensitive area, then the EAW is required. And in the original application, they indicated they would like to have 30 of them. And I guess it's my opinion that that would be resolved, or that would take place at the time we actually get a permit application for what they intend to do up there. So that's my opinion, and I don't know if Aaron, if you have a different opinion than that, or...
I did have a chance to look at the regulation, and I concur with Bill. I don't think the issue of whether or not an EAW is needed is ripe at this moment. Once the CUP is applied for, we have to wait and see if they're actually applying for RVs, and if they are applying for RVs over 25, then at that time the EAW would be necessary, but at this time it's not an issue that the board needs to decide.
I guess I also talked to Janelle Mersch, who's the DNR hydrologist up in Fergus Falls, in regard to if she has any additional comments on the language that's proposed. And she responded to me with an email that says, unless the original plans and or intent has changed for the proposed use of the former Luther Crest property, the DNR has no further comment. My letter dated April 9th, 2012 was written to remind the decision makers that there are state and local laws limiting impervious surface, building height setback from ordinary high water, etc. Land use decisions are made locally. If the project proposal does not adhere to the shoreline and floodplain ordinances, DNR will be involved. If the ordinances are followed, we will not have any further involvement. So I guess
there was another letter, was there not?
Oh, the one that Commissioner Vannon sent?
Well, I sent you a letter too, Bill. Are you going to read that into the record?
Well, I think they were emailed. The commissioners were emailed.
I think I should point out, yeah, there's been numerous emails, numerous letters. And again, I think we have not read the majority of these in a public setting as such, but each commissioner has received that either by mail or by email or a combination thereof, and our practice has not been to read every correspondence on this particular issue. So I think if we were to do that, we'd be here for an hour or two reading this. So. With that, is there any other comments from those in attendance today?
Thank you. For the record, I'm Jerry Hurtas. I'm president of the Nairoka Club, and my address is 8055 Davis Street in Greenfield, Minnesota. I do want to point out with respect to the letter from Ms. Janelle Mersch that was issued for the Planning and Zoning Committee meeting. There was a lot of discussion going on while that was being read into the record, and I'd like to point out that specifically in the letter, it refers to the Shoreland Ordinance. Now, The Minnesota Department of Natural Resources established the shoreline ordinances in the late 1980s. In 2007, they required the counties to either adopt the model ordinance or opt out and create your own ordinance, which would be subject to review. The county is reminded that the request to rezone the property doesn't preclude the shoreline ordinance, and you folks have adopted the model ordinance. The model ordinance states that the S1 and S2 districts were established to protect the shoreline and the aesthetic quality of the shoreline. And it attempts to do that through limited land uses. It's clear that the model and the intent of the model ordinance was to restrict the land uses. And that being said, in the letter dated April 9th, the county was reminded by Ms. Mirisch that each smaller unit of government must be at least as restrictive as the next largest, therefore meaning Stevens County must be at least restrictive as the state. So the state did not intend this to be a more liberal use of the land. And in creating and proposing an S3 zone, you are actually, in my judgment, opposing the state statute. Secondly, with regard to the applicant's request, I'd just like to, for the record, remind that in every instance in which the applicants have publicly stated that they don't have any intention with proceeding with the RV campground at this time, they still have not withdrawn that in any manner or form from their application. The issue is not whether or not our neighbors, the O'Reillys, or ourselves oppose the uses that they initially had stated, and that would be the continued use of the facilities for the banquet facility and doing those types of things. And what is problematic is that regardless of who the fee owner of the property would be in the future, that rezoning this property simply would allow any use to occur under the PUD. And so their intentions may be honorable, but that doesn't inure to the next property owner. In addition, I feel it's really important that we understand that these folks have formed a B&H Holdings, an LLC. This is an investment type of holding. And they really had a duty in my mind to be knowledgeable about what the limited uses of this property were when they purchased it. And I don't think it's a function of your local government during the review process to consider the economic impact of the applicants or to fix an economic hardship which they brought upon themselves. Under Minnesota Statutes 103F211 is the model ordinance that you adopted. It specifically states that the preservation of natural shorelands shall be accomplished through restrictive land uses. That's part of the model ordinance that you have adopted. Subdivision 3 also says that approval of the Commissioners of Health and Pollution Control Agency are required if you change or amend the model ordinance. And quote from the statute, the model standards and ordinance adopted under the section or amendments to them must not be finally adopted until approved by the Commissioner of Health and the Pollution Control Agency. So I would, for the record, state that if it's in your decision that you need to go through with this S3, it's going to have to be reviewed by the MPCA. Lastly, of the seven lakes that have been assessed on the Pomme de Terre chain, only five of them support recreational uses of the water. The MPCA has classified Pomme de Terre as a non-supporting recreational use. It's an impaired water. And the definitions are fully supporting, partially supporting, or non-supporting. And so the very need and claim to establish this new S3 zoning district, as they're being functionally dependent upon water uses, calls into the question the very resource itself, Perkins Lake. And so I would ask you to take that into consideration. Any future use or intense use is going to contribute to the impaired water quality. Thank you.
Okay, with that, is there any other comments? Try and keep it to 3 minutes. I got a little bit windy on that last one there, so.
My name's Paul Harmon. My address is 54 Glengarry Parkway, Edina, Minnesota. I'm a member of the Nairoka Club also, and also for purposes of disclosures, I'm a lawyer by trade. I just want to emphasize to the county the strong interest that the state has and the county has in adopting the shoreline ordinance and the preservation of the land and resources that are involved in this project. Under the shoreline ordinance, the purposes of that ordinance and the county in adopting it are the appropriate use of land and water resources to preserve the natural and environmental resources and to allow appropriate and reasonable uses within those purposes. There is some historical use of this property for events and gatherings, although that use is probably non-conforming under the current CUP, which may have been grandfathered in at one point under the previous uses of the property, but since the CUP in 1992, those uses wouldn't be grandfathered in, although we would support some use of the property and development for those events and gatherings. However, the permitted use under the CUP and that historical use and for gatherings and events related to that is clearly a much less dense and intense land use than the allowable uses under the proposed zoning amendment. The proposed zoning amendment goes to a much higher density of both persons on the property. In the CUP was for youth gatherings of up to 50 at a time. Clearly the density under the proposed use under the amendment would be much higher than that, and the intensity of the land use would be much higher, the demand on the land and water resources. So the economic uses allowed under the amended the zoning amendment would be much higher in density and intensity to the both the shoreline ordinance, purpose of the shoreline ordinance, and the current CUP, which is contrary to the whole interest of the state in drafting the shoreline ordinance and asking the counties to impose that and the county's adoption of that. So the economic uses, while important and valuable, and certainly some would be supportive, have to be balanced against the purpose of the shoreline ordinance in protecting the land and water resources through appropriate use. Thanks.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Mr. Chairman, I have a question for Bill. When Mr. Hurtaw was questioning about the RVs, 25 and above, that will, when they apply for a conditional use permit, that will be handled at that time, correct?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay. So it has nothing to do with this here S3 zone thing, the number of campers, because that will be taken care of when the conditional, if a conditional use permit is applied for and granted, correct?
Yeah, in my opinion, that's when that topic would come up. If they propose anything 25 or more in that sensitive area, shoreline area, that would trigger a mandatory EAW.
Okay, with that, I'll close the public comment portion. And I think before us, we've got two resolutions. If you want to talk about that a little bit, Bill.
I guess two resolutions, the first being for consideration, resolution adopting an amendment to Section 7, Shoreline Management Ordinance of the Stevens County Zoning Ordinance for the purpose of adding a water-oriented commercial shoreline district. The resolution talks about that Section 25 in our county zoning ordinance allows for amendments to occur. The next whereas paragraph indicates that the Planning Commission held a public meeting on April 16, 2012 to allow for public comment on the changes to the sections that are being proposed to be amended. And also talks about that currently the ordinance doesn't allow for resorts, campgrounds, or certain water-oriented commercial uses. And the county intends to propose amendments to provide opportunities for the existing or future commercial uses adjacent to water resources that are functionally dependent on such close proximity to lands deemed appropriate by Stevens County. Planning Commission recommended to the board approval, and it just simply states the sections at the bottom of the resolution that are proposed to be amended. Now, the other resolution is for a resolution adopting an amendment to the official Stevens County zoning map, where it states Minnesota 394 gives authority for adoption of such controls and allows for creation of zoning districts and maps depicting such zoning districts. There again, it indicates the Planning Commission recommended passage to the County Board of Commissioners on April 16th. And it describes the property at the end of the resolution that is supposed to be rezoned. So I guess the county board may either adopt the amendment or any part thereof of it, or deny it. And the amendment would only be effective if 4/5 of the commissioners votes for its passage. Any questions?
Any questions of the board?
Mr. Chairman, I would like to...
There's been kind of some misinformation out there that I ask a lot of questions because I am opposed to something. That's not necessarily true. This is all a new process for me. I ask questions because I want to learn so I can make an informed decision. So.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to thank Bill and the Planning Commission for the work that they put into this. I would like to make a motion to accept the resolution for the amendment.
Okay, that motion again is a resolution adopting an amendment to the official Stevens County zoning map. That would be the first one, correct, huh?
No, we should do the other one. The amendment set to Section 7.
Okay.
My
fault on that one.
I would second that motion.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there a further discussion on the... Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Okay, now...
Mr. Chairman, I would move to adopt the amendment to the official Stevens County zoning map.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Further discussion on that resolution. Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Anything else, Bill?
We'll have to publish that in the newspaper. We'll have to draft up some a summary, I guess, because there's charts and tables in there that may be too lengthy for the publishing. So we'll work on getting that published in the newspaper.
And the concerns with the campground and things like that will be addressed in the CUP.
Yes, if or when or whatever their plans are for that. Well, it will be if they plan to use the property, the pavilion and the cabins, and overnight camping. Now, that's going to have to be a condition of use permit as well as any future plans for any sort of RV park or any other sort of use out there. It's going to have a condition of use permit, which is going to come before the Stevens County Planning Commission. Probably you. And as our ordinance says, the planning commission is the final decision body on conditional use for level comments.
Because the way I understood it, the only way for them to be able to use the pavilion, of which there was no opposition to, was to create this zone.
Now, I guess we talked about the variance process. Aaron didn't feel that was appropriate to do it. The only way to do it would be through conditional use permit, which is similar to the Bible camp use, but that was allowed prior to the 2007 amendment, as well as it's actually allowed yet as the CUP for youth camps and Bible camps. That didn't change.
Okay, thank you, Bill. And thank you, everyone, for your attendance. Okay, Brian, do you want to get caught up first before you move on?
I'm ready.
Yes, if you'd like. Go ahead.
I always like it when Brian has to switch chairs. Very important stuff. 3 minutes, little still on Brian.
3 minutes, you say?
All right. Do the business quicker than 3 minutes. Now,
look at these long-winded letters.
Yeah.
First item on the agenda. A couple of resolutions for your consideration, one for each of the grants that we were approved and were able to obtain, that accept the grant terms and conditions. It lays out the amount of the grant, and it says that we will pay the additional funding necessary to complete the project. At the same time, as you consider those resolutions or right after some long corporate authorization for the board chair and myself to execute the actual agreements themselves, in which these resolutions will be an attachment to. So the first one is for bridge bonding. That is for the new bridge construction on South 13. We've awarded that contract and held the pre-con, and the eligible amount of money for the grant is $26,929.80. So, you go to act on that first.
Speaker. Mr. Chairman, I would offer a motion to accept the resolution regarding the bridge replacement.
I'll make it.
Okay, we have a motion, second by Phil, I think. Further discussion on that resolution? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
The second is a very similar situation. This is for local road improvement project grant. You've heard about that in this year's bonding bill. They did another local road improvement money in that bonding bill. We were successful in obtaining $250,000. That will be on the Alberta reconstruction of Main Street project.
Okay. Okay, with that, is there a motion to?
This was your close.
No. Is there a motion to approve that resolution?
Mr. Chairman, I'll make that motion.
Okay, we have a motion. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Further discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Would you like to take separate action to authorize the board chair and myself to execute the grant agreements?
Does it need to be done?
I don't, there's been examples of where you've done both with formal agreements, for the appropriate signature. So I don't feel that it's absolutely necessary in order for the grant to be valid. It's just if you're wishing to do so. Consensus is fine.
You want it done?
Can't hurt to do it.
I'll make that a motion to that the county engineer and the board chair execute the grant agreements.
I'll second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Okay. The next three items are all connected. And earlier last week, I got a township maintenance contract, the same one I would use with every township, that had been executed by Swan Lake Township. So evidently they had taken action and Tom had signed and forwarded it to me for consideration. Swan Lake Township is asking if Stevens County will once again, as we did prior to when we first started these in 2009, do their summer blading and their winter snow removal. So the first item would be to whether or not you'd like to accept that. The second is a request on my part to both hire a heavy equipment operator, maintenance workers. I feel we've crossed a threshold that we would need additional staff in order to perform this along with the other townships that we do, and also a new unit, in this case a new motor grader, to accomplish that work. And it's not only that work that, of course, we need to get done, but we've been saying for some time we're on the fringe of our ability to accomplish this many miles of road and maintenance, summer and winter. And in fact, last winter, although it was a nice mild winter as far as snowfall goes, we had a contractor in place doing a route. This would basically stop that contract, and we then would service that winter route plus break our summer blade routes into five instead of four. So with that, I stand for questions.
Brian, give me a quick update as to what our count is again for townships.
If we accept Swan Lake Township, we'll be blading seven townships in the summer. And we will be plowing snow for 14 townships in the winter.
And where are the non-participating townships? Are they in Southwest?
Most of the townships we don't service are in the Southwest. Specifically for doing summer blading, for blading. For winter, they're actually in the far north and southeast.
Moore and
Rensville.
Rensville.
We don't do anything for. The ones that we do everything for, except for hauling gravel and mowing, is El Dorado, Pepperton, Horton, Hodges, Framis, Swan Lake, and Donovan. Is that right?
So, Brian, how many townships can one operator do?
It takes about 12, on average, about 12 hours to blade one township.
So we'll be starting 10-hour days soon, but under an 8-hour day, which is an easier common denominator with 12, it takes about 3 days to do 2 townships. And then each route currently has about 52 or 53 miles of county road to do as well, which take 2 to 3 days, usually about 3 days to get around that deal. So a full week to each. So theoretically 4 blades can cover it, but you better not really lose a day. And that's why we're pushing to do it this way, is I feel, and my supervisor feels, that this will allow us additional flexibility for using that manpower when we're doing, say, shouldering activities, or we have people gone on vacation and whatnot. We want to try and keep our trucks rolling and our mowing going. And what we'll find ourselves doing more and more, and what we're already doing, is pulling people from other primary jobs to fill the hot item of the day. And thus, at the end of the year, we lose a little bit. Certainly, we have some options to hire more work done. But I think we're very competitive with the... You consider our own costs and some of our fixed costs that we have, no matter how many units we have. I think we're very competitive with what it would be to hire people to do this for profit. We're, of course, not seeking profit. So as I run the numbers, I think this is a necessary move, and that's why I'm recommending.
What do you anticipate? I know it's hard to do down the road. We're going to pick up some more. I mean, we play this game all the time, but...
Yeah. There's been a few townships that have been poking around asking about rates and things like this. There's a few factors, of course. One is the membership of the township. When that rotates, sometimes it changes one way or another. We lose and we gain back, and that's similar to what happened with Framis and Swan Lake. I think our experience record with Framis and Swan Lake shows that if we're an option, we're a preferred option. It took them all 2 years to be paid when we come back. Nothing against the other contractors, it's just we have a larger staff able to deploy, and if they have a breakdown or there's a number of factors. Sometimes the township board members, they just simply don't want to make a decision about whether they have to be plowing or not, and they prefer that be done at our level, as long as we're doing it anyway. So there's multiple different factors. It really comes down to sometimes it takes very little to upset the apple cart and lose a job, and I think contractors are all too familiar with that, and that's why at some point in time we might gain other townships. Is
by the same token,
we could lose townships, yeah.
Even though we have that agreement, it's kind of loose in a sense too, where, you know, we add more people, we buy more equipment, and Framis and Swan Lake dropped us like a hot potato before. Really, there's nothing really that connects. And what word am I looking for?
Commitment.
More commitment, yeah, that's good.
But you're asking them to be in until September 14th.
Right, well, there's cancellation clauses.
Yeah.
So they can get out with notice. We have to react to that, as would any business. If we lost 4 townships in 2014, we renew this, we change rates. In fact, that's another reason. You know, all of a sudden the rate changes and they think it's better another way. Same game a lot of people play with health insurance and things like that. But anyway, we're going to have to be willing to lay off employees or sell equipment, liquidate if we have to. The bottom line is we're agreeing to do this, and I want to do it well when we do it. And it doesn't make any sense to me to agree to service 14 townships and then ask contractors to do our work for us. If they want a contractor to do it, they would hire a contractor to do it. So why be the middleman in that stuff? It just doesn't make sense to me. I want to provide a quality service where we're wanted, we're required to do it in the county, and just adding more responsibility without the tools is hindering our ability to do that. And we'll continue to do that the more we add.
How often do you blade townships?
We blade them, most all the contracts ask for 2 weeks. The reality is we blade them more than every 2 weeks around now, early in the year when you're trying to get them in shape. And we blade them less, probably around 3 weeks to a month in July when it's dry. If we get rains, we try and do it more. And then in the fall again, it's more frequent. But in aggregate, about every 2 weeks, we do every township. And our roads are about on the same rotation. We have roads that we have to blade every week, and we have some that we don't. And although the townships, we try and say an expectation of 2 weeks, the reality is there's townships that they probably like us for that regard too. We're out and about, and we know where the traffic volumes are, and there are township roads we do weekly, and there's some that we don't do, you know, we do more monthly. For instance, in El Dorado, they have a lot of dirt roads, and they want them bladed, but clearly we don't have to blade a dirt road every 2 weeks. So, you know, we balance that. Contractors have a harder time with that. You know, they have a set schedule, and they have to beat through it, and they do the whole township, and then they mark it on the calendar, and 2 weeks later they do it. And the reason is you have to be in that business. You have to keep your thing moving. As long as it's not raining, well, we might not do, and then wait for a rain, and then, you know, hurry up and try and get them all done. And that's also a reason why we think we're recommending 5 motor graders is, under the current loads, there are roads we're getting, it's too dry by the time we get there. And if we split it up into 5, we'll provide a better service as we're doing it, with some ability to take on future requests and not have to go through this, you know, again. And if we dropped back down to, I mean, I think we can justify 5, really. We could have, you know, when we took on Swan Lake, we talked about that. Or, I mean, Framis, excuse me. It wouldn't have paid as close, but I think the workload justifies the person there. We've been at this level as far back as 2013. We had this additional employee, not the unit, but we had the employee to keep more things going. So this isn't an unprecedented level of employees for us by any stretch. It's in relative recent history that we've had this level of employment at the highway department. And you know, so we think this will be a better service for everybody, but there's a cost associated, and we respect the process as we recommend it, and we do with what we have.
We have a great bunch of guys that do our road work. Is it an option to do overtime for them?
Overtime's an option. I have some concerns about burnout.
Mm-hmm.
The summer option we're on 410s, what we really need to make it work is to work 5 days a week. For this year, you know, I think we could do some things, but my recommendation to the board, if we chose an overtime type of model, would be to negotiate that into contracts for a different schedule. I think we'd have to go to a 5-day schedule if you think that we should do this with 4 routes. And there'll be some opposition to that. And it might be something you have to purchase, but it's certainly something that I think we'll have to do with everybody and not just 4 people. And my anticipated cost of doing the overtime will exceed the cost of a person.
And I think too, with 5 routes in the wintertime with 14 townships, there's a lot of overtime already, or will be, I should say. Do you agree with that?
It fluctuates, certainly.
Depending on the winter, of course, but yeah.
Right now, winter overtime is actually at best going to stay the same, and it's probably going to get worse, because you have to remember that we were already taking that extra route as a contractor. So in fact, we'll have the same number of routes we had last year, but more miles to service. So in fact, we're already adding on, should we add the position, we're already adding overtime in the winter by this scenario during the evenings. And they take, I looked at it, the average township has been taking us in the winter a surprising more than what I was anticipating. On the low end, 4, on the high end, 6, 6.5 hours each. So when you think about, we're going to have 11 routes, is what it would come to. And you have 11 routes, 14 townships that are going to take themselves 5 hours on average each. You know, you have almost no ability to run around any county roads twice, which in fact would probably be the preferred level of service. So what happens with us is we open them, essentially, and if the wind doesn't blow the next day, we push them back a little wider and limit the overtime into one day. But oftentimes, you know, the stuff we hit first can blow shut by the time we're even done for the day. Not shut, but over the road to some extent. So,
long term, down the road, your item 5, which isn't on here, but I assume will come up, will be a facility. Can you house this equipment if we added another one?
Right now, we're having one piece of equipment housed in Hancock Concrete. That's probably not a perfect long-term solution, but it seemed to be working in the infancy stages of taking care of Hancock. And that works pretty good for us when we're working in Hancock to have a machine right there. And that'll free up enough bay space in the wintertime to get most all of these primary units in. In the summertime, no, we won't fit everything in there. We don't currently with pups on the trucks and that type of thing. Facilities should be on your radar screen. I'm not out jumping for one, but we have certain needs that are going to be more pressing as time goes on. We have issues that we address on a not emergency, but we react to issues as they arise. But it's a 1963 facility, and at some point in time, it's going to have to be updated.
And on the township roads, are they 2 passes, or do you do 3 on the township roads?
Most of the township roads, we do 2.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But the county roads, you do 3?
Most of the county roads, we do 3. They're just too wide to do those 2.
Most of the townships, like for snow plowing, they really don't have any other options. I mean, as far as hiring somebody, because nobody, I mean, other than what's the guy from Hancock, Lonneman, he's the only one that does it anymore. He just does one township.
Well, I think Stevens County. Lawson would have still done it, I think. There's a void. There is an opportunity there for individuals who would be looking to get into it, but the truth be told, it's you've got a lot of investment and variable workload and a huge risk for breakdowns, inconvenient scheduling. It's not an attractive private business. High complaints. Low reward.
Okay, any other questions? I guess the first thing on the agenda would be approval of the township maintenance contract with Swan Lake Township. And that would be 2012-13-14.
Effective August 1st. Now to September 30th, 2014, at which time our intent will be to refresh the agreements with every township.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make that motion to enter into an agreement with Swan Lake Township.
Okay, we have a motion, is there a second?
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same side? Motion carried. Okay, item... C, request to hire full-time heavy equipment operator.
The little double star down in the bottom there?
I saw that. I was gonna comment on that. You shouldn't have put that on there.
Well, I would rather you, you tabled it than said no. And then had to ask you again another time, let's put it that way.
Well, I think...
The request, I don't anticipate changing my mind on the request, but I do anticipate reacting to what your final decision are, making the adjustments we need to make it as successful as possible.
Brian, I had a question as far as the motor grader. Don't you have to go out for bids on that?
We get quotes. The reason we don't have to go out for bids is that we use the state contracting provisions through the state contract that they have to submit.
I think by approving item two, how you want to play it, put it, painted ourselves in the corner, we're almost, I think, required to approve item three and four to make this work. I mean, we're going to take this work on, and we need to, I think, do it in a timely manner. And then obviously, if we're contracting some of it already, and we're finding more work on, I guess I'd like to, I would see down the road that I think that they should be on a 5-day week. Also, I would agree with Brian on that. That's something we need to probably look at down the road. But I don't know how you can, you know, we keep taking these on and then stretching ourselves thinner and thinner.
Well, I think the approach that you've used has been the right thing to do. You know, asking them to be in for a period of time gives you your best opportunity to try to plan for it. And I think this is a continuation of that, and that we should move ahead. You don't perceive people bailing out on the agreements?
No, my radar screen.
Even until the end of the said period?
I can't anticipate somebody going to come in and try and offer the cost. No.
It would take somebody to come in and through some perception, at least do it cheaper and start taking over market share, and then also be satisfied with that service. What you saw in Framis and Swan Lake, for whatever reason, is a perception that it would be cheaper because it was per hour, and then they got their monthly invoices and it wasn't necessarily cheaper or close. And then some, not all residents, feeling not as comfortable with the service. So they said, well, I guess it's not all about hourly wages, it's also about other factors. But, you know, nothing against the contractor at all. I think he did a fine job. It's just change for people.
But my original supposition is that you're not going to lose the townships that have committed to the agreement until the said period is up, and then we'll reassess it.
I don't think you're going to lose them as long as you're providing a good service.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the key.
And I guess in the event,
I think we have been.
So. In the event we do lose them, Brian's already alluded to the fact that you lay people off and sell the equipment.
Yeah, you find a balance. The preferred method, of course, would be to do it through attrition. And we have some of that coming. I mean, I have two anticipated retirements in the next 3 years, I would say. So there's opportunity there, and that's how these, I mean, if you were around in 2009, you'd remember that as a point of conversation. We've got a retirement coming up. The machine is ready for renewal. Should we go ahead and do it, or should we? And we were basically going to say, well, let's see how many townships we get if we actually look at this differently. We studied the entire issue, and we said, well,
Well, in fact, we, at one point, I came right out and said, we don't want to do townships, and it wasn't long before, I think, the message was received, we're gonna. And so, you know, we agreed to do these, we thought we were gonna end up with about half as many as we did. We got a lot of them back, and we're done nothing but increase in numbers. And our idea that we were gonna attrition people and reduce our fleet and be able to fit in our building better, it just, that's just not what's happening. You know, we've agreed to do these, and you know, we're sad.
Do these equipment companies, do they still have a buyback program or not?
There is a buyback program, yes. And it's just simply, in my opinion, it's not financially wise as it used to be. Just doesn't pay off. The value they're gonna be willing to give you at, say, year five is its same value at year 10 with twice as many hours, so we've been keeping them. We will have one of these four current motor graders will be 12 years old next year. So, I mean, you know, it didn't take us long to move from a five-year buyback to 12 years.
Okay, let's, any more questions pertaining to the hire of a full-time heavy equipment operator?
Is that like the cart before the horse? Should we do the motor grader first? Because if we vote the motor grader down, you don't need the operator.
That's right. That's right. It's a package deal for sure.
Do it together.
Yeah, you certainly can do it together. As far as timing goes, the motor grader is going to be probably at least 45 days out, probably more like 60. So the advertisement for the worker, I would try and coordinate pretty close. It wouldn't be an immediate advertisement, so it's just getting all the processes ready and figuring out the best advertisement time. And I'm not sure that I can give, as far as your if you would decide to go ahead with the purchase of the motor grader, would like not to tie exactly to those dollar numbers, because although there should be pretty spot on, I want to make sure we give a good rating through the specifications and that everything's on there. But this should be within 1%, I would say.
Mr. Chairman, I'd make a motion to approve the request to purchase a new motor grader and tie that into the request to hire a full-time heavy equipment operator maintenance worker.
Okay, you heard the motion. Is there a second to that motion?
Is he squirming yet?
He's ready. Yeah.
Is there a second to the motion?
I'll second.
Further discussion.
Does that come out of road and bridge reserve then, or
we'll purchase? We'll have to purchase it this year on reserves. It isn't a budgeted item, and make it work. But yeah, the initial purchase will be out of our cash reserves.
And what about the wages then?
The wages this year should be easily covered, I think. First of all, it won't start till probably around August. And beginning the end of this month, I'll be short engineering tech supervisor for probably at least 5 months or something. So wage-wise, we should come all fine. It'll be a little bit off department by department.
Plus you'll have additional revenue from that township, correct?
Correct.
John Deere's a state bid, but how does that compare to a Caterpillar? I don't think Herb would agree with your request.
Well, our previous purchase was a John Deere motor grader, and one of the selling points is that it still has a steering wheel. Caterpillar motor graders no longer have steering wheels, and I think that works pretty good for their grading industry. But when you're plowing snow, if you can kind of imagine molding some joysticks and hitting a drift, it's pretty, it's hard. The steering's all in one and all the blade controls are in the other. So if you so much as bump that steering one, you're going. So the preferred is to have something to hang on to instead of the seatbelt catching you. That's the biggest thing. But it's with regard to cost, the John Deere is about going to be right in the neighborhood of $23,000 cheaper than the Cat. Our experience also, which is, should be a bigger factor, is the John Deere currently, and we can talk about where the relic is and who the operator is, but it's currently almost twice the fuel efficiency of the Cat. So.
Is it not green?
Okay, with that, I'll call the question. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried.
One last thing that I had, Jim. What?
You can take your thumb out of the dice now.
One last thing that I had added to the agenda. This is something that I normally just would deal with myself, but with this dollar amount, I think it would be appropriate for the board to take action to award the contract. And I took quotations on the box cover replacement at CASA 17. We talked about that as a maintenance project. It's done through maintenance funds, not construction funds. And it serves County Ditch 15. The total cost of the contract is $66,708. I'm seeking approval to go ahead and contract with Comfort Construction and Gravel to perform that work as a low bid.
The amount again?
$66,708.
I'll make that a motion.
That's how you accept.
Okay, we have a motion, second, further discussion. Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried.
Hey, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Neil.
So added the
secondary schools.
Okay, we have any questions on the warrants today?
First page, that Ben Olson, I thought that he was retained by B&H.
He's retained by us as well.
Okay.
He does a good job.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I've got a clean one, should I sign that?
Yep.
All right. Is there a motion to approve the vouchers, warrants, et cetera?
So moved.
I'll move.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion and second, further discussion. Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried.
The other item that was added was the Eagles would like to make a donation out of their gambling funds again. would be for the Ag Society, and it'd be for operational and maintenance items as they have in the past. Mike Siak didn't give me exact amount, he said $10,000 to $11,000, so usually they specify the exact amount on them. Getting pinned down on it, but
I don't recall the exact dollar amount of the Eagles officers took action on that last night, but I think it was $9,000-something or another.
$9,000.
But I didn't jot it down, I did jot it down, but I don't have it with me. And that pertains to the Rock the Browns that happens second weekend in July or whatever. I think it's kind of a, I don't know how that equation works, but anyway.
That's a junction with Prairie Grandeur, I guess, right?
Yep.
I make a motion to accept the proceeds from the Eagles Gambling Fund for that purpose.
Okay, we have a motion, is there a second?
I'll second it.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, motion carried.
Neil, I have another question for you today. We are advised that we are not involved in any redistricting as commissioners. Can you supply some supporting information with regard to that? Since this,
you weren't required to, so it kind of stays status quo. We're informing the state auditor or Secretary of State's office that there would be no redistricting. Is there any formalities for the board to go to? I mean, there is no redistricting.
I mean, that has to be based on population movement.
Right, and because the city of Morris was, in our case, the thing that we thought was going to trigger it, and because they, Blaine had discovered that they didn't actually have wards. If you have wards, you have, in the city, you elect your representative to those specific wards. City does at large, so they could come from anywhere in the city. Because of that, the other thing tied in there was that if you have wards, the areas are supposed to be contiguous or adjacent to each other. And the thing that was that we thought we were looking at there was, I believe it was in your district, Paul, where they brought in that annexed area. Or actually it was in Phil's district, the annexed area over there. It does touch on the north side with the township areas, but within the city itself it didn't. But because it wasn't a ward, or they're not wards anymore, they dropped that term, we never really were, then that contiguous requirement is not there, so they can remain as they are. And so there was no need for the board to redistrict, so. You know, you can always choose to do that, even though it's not required. The city did not do that then, so there was no requirements on you to do so. And, I spoke with Larry about that. They will remain as they were for the next 10 years. So. Is that?
Well, I'm going to accept that, but you know, what I was interested in seeing is what kind of changes there were in populations in different districts.
I can give you some spreadsheets that we did to show how they balanced out. If there's over a 5% change in a district, then that triggers redistricting, but there was not. So that, you know.
Well, I would be interested in seeing the hard numbers.
Sure, no, that's no problem. And it's not only, you know, you could have 5% from someplace else go in and 5% go out to some other area, but that's actually considered, like, let's say there was 5 and or 4 and 4, that would actually be an 8% change. They don't look at that as offsetting each other, but that did not occur. So, yeah, actually the state itself
sent out a package that said that we weren't required to do it because there was not enough population change, so, and then we verified it, and that was the case, but I can certainly give that to you all, so, anybody else like that, just email it out, so.
Yeah, why don't you email it to me too, I guess I, certainly there had to be some percent, you know, as small as it might be, but just curious.
There's a couple things I figured that, I'll send out what I've got for you so you can take me good now, so.
Okay. Thanks, Neil.
Thank you.
Have we missed anything on the agenda?
No, there's no.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
No.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, motion carried. It's part of your new.